those who are viewing live stream, we have the words to the hymns. You will not, but they're familiar hymns, and I hope you'll be able to follow along as well. Our service begins on the inside of the front cover of the bulletin. We gather this day to honor the Lord of life and to remember his servant, Norm Anderson. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of all mercy and the God of all consolation. He comforts together us in all our sorrows so that we can comfort others in their sorrows with the consolation we ourselves have received from God. Amen. St. Paul writes in Romans chapter 6, when we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried with him, therefore, by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a resurrection like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. Let us pray. Eternal God, you are the maker of heaven and earth. You formed us from the dust of the earth, and by your breath gave us life. Jesus Christ, you are the resurrection and the life.
From the grave to open the way to eternal life. Holy Spirit, you are the author and giver of life. You comfort all who sorrow and offer sure confidence and everlasting hope. To you, O blessed Trinity, be glory and honor forever and ever. Amen. We join in singing our opening song printed on the insert in the bulletin, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God, based on Psalm 46.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O God of grace, O God of eternal glory, we remember before you this day our brother in the faith, Norm Anderson. Lord, we thank you for giving him to us to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see that death has been swallowed up in the victory of our Lord Jesus Christ, so that we may live in confidence and hope until by your call we are gathered to our heavenly home in the company of all your saints. We ask this through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated. I've chosen a number of scripture readings for this day, beginning with the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And Psalm 121, the first of 13 pilgrimage psalms that the children of Israel would recite on their way to Jerusalem for the festivals, on their way home, and that they'd recite in liturgy on the 13 steps going up to the temple. So this is one of those psalms about our journeys of life. I will lift up my eyes unto the mountains. From whence cometh my help? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to slip. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not smite you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will protect you from all evil. He will keep your soul. The Lord will guard your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. And the final reading from the Psalms, the pure message of the gospel, contained from Genesis to Revelation, spoken so clearly here in Psalm 130. Out of the depths I have cried to thee, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplication. If you, Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with you, that you may be feared. I wait for the Lord. My soul does wait and in his word do I hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than the watchman for the morning, yea, more than the watchman for the morning. O Israel, people of God, hope in the Lord. For with the Lord there is loving kindness, and with him is abundant redemption, and he will redeem Israel from all his iniquities. This time I'd like to invite family members to come to the lectern. There's a stool there. I think there's some grandchildren maybe speaking, and if they need it, there's a stool. And we invite you to come at this time, and if you're willing to share with us.
There was a Cynthia and Norm 1 and a Cynthia and Norm 2. Today I want to honor Norm 2. After many deaths in our family, in 2004, Cynthia and Norm married and filled in all those empty seats, those empty places in our family's heart. Cynthia's children and Eddie and I were blessed seamlessly with the most amazing, incredible people that we could now call family. We will always call them family. The love and dedication between Norm and Cynthia was the most wonderful thing in the world and will serve as an inspiration to me and all of us of what marriage should be like for the rest of my life. Illness and struggles just brought them closer together, if that was indeed possible. Norm always seemed so pleasantly surprised when I made him liver and onions or stuffed cabbage, kolache, pizzelles, and he often asked me why I did that. That was why, Normie. I could never ever thank you enough for just being you, my wonderful brother-in-law, and for the gift of our precious family. Thank you. I love you. I'd like to read just a short verse from The Little Prince by Antoine de Saint-Exupéry. In one of those stars I shall be living. In one of them I shall be laughing. And so it will be as if all the stars were laughing when you look at the sky at night. And when your sorrow is comforted, time soothes all sorrows, you will be content that you have known me. You will always be my friend. I shall not leave you. Thank you.
Growing up as dad's daughter, that was good fun. As a little girl, dad was larger than life. His voice, his face, that mustache. I live for the moments when he would lift me up onto his shoulders. The view from that height, pretty spectacular. Childhood was full of experiences that only now, as a parent myself, I can fully appreciate. But it's the feelings I had in those moments that I will remember most. How my entire body would rumble when he fired up the dragster at the starting line of a race, furiously pedaling that tiny clown bike that he'd make me ride while he rode his big wheel in the 4th of July parade. Sitting next to him on a chairlift, heading to the top of a black diamond with his ski poles pressed against my belly, somehow keeping me from falling out as we leaned over to pick our route down. Those comforting smells, the rhythms of his finely tuned engines, the joy of riding shotgun in the Roadster, and that one time, I promise you, it was only one time, he let me drive. Sitting quietly in the library at 190 Chapel, sharing books, ideas, and stories, that overwhelming love I felt when he walked me down the aisle. I'll remember how even in the most difficult moments of my life, he was there to remind me it will be okay. With love, with family, with time, it will be okay. My father would be the first to admit that he was not perfect, but to me, he could have not been a more perfect dad. Dad never missed that opportunity to tell you he loved you, to tell you he was proud of you. Tonight, when I go home, I will hold my children. I will remember the love I have for them is the unconditional love he had for all of us.
It's no exaggeration that the majority of my happiest memories since I was 9 years old involve Norm. I remember when he first started dating Mom, how excited I would get when he pulled into the driveway, how we bonded over a love of Smarties, and how a turf war featuring a pink flamingo made us laugh our butts off. At age 12, I remember taking my friends to see Norm's engines at the fair, showing him and them off like he and they were the coolest things in the world, and they were. I remember his patience with me, teaching me how to drive, and parallel parking was maybe the only time I could sense any frustration with me. If Norm said that he was proud of you, he was. If he said that he loved you, he did. If he said that he was so grateful for you, there was no doubt in your mind that he was. From my beloved sister Lisa, who can't be here today, she would like to share this. For me, it's so cliche, but the phrase never met a stranger should be reserved for Norm only, since anybody else would pale in comparison. And how free he was with his emotions and his love was so impactful for us and the girls. And Deanna and Bella would like to share that, I love your face, I love your face, I love your face. And they love the memory of all the cousins being read to by Pop Pop in the green room.
You can move the stool if it needs to be moved.
Well, I was going to say, I don't know who in the Anderson family will need a stool.
Okay.
Remembering Pop-Pop isn't hard to do. There's no shortage of fond and funny memories when it comes to my dad. So we thought it would be a fitting to just mention a short list of the things he did that made us laugh. The gift he gave to all of us throughout his life. Okay, I'm gonna laugh now. How many people gave you an award for having the most structurally sound or the most fantastic postmodern gingerbread house? Pop-Pop did, and he also would have recommended your gingerbread house to be admitted to the National Register of Historic Places. just after you, after that small crack in the roof was fixed. His gift of casually starting a conversation, drawing you in because it was somewhat interesting, carefully leading you down the path of believability, and when your guard was completely down, would end up with a punchline that would make you roll your eyes because you fell for it, or cracking up because you didn't care. You were once again baited and hooked. Unfailingly, his stories always ended with the phrase, "May God be my judge." Like that was going to make us believe him. And did anyone else know that he had his own special stories just for the grandkids? I didn't, but it's not surprising. One of the most memorable, I've been told, was the story of the black bear that would come to the backyard at the house and Pop-Pop would feed it cucumbers, sometimes tomatoes, mostly cucumbers. Maybe you'd finally get a peek at the bear on this visit to Pop-Pop and Nona's house. Many of the things that the grandchildren remember are things that my brothers and sisters and I remember as children, like sitting on his knee while he bounced us to the William Tell Overture, or tucking us in at night with the obligatory bouncity, bouncity, bounce. Regretfully, the grandkids never experienced entire Saturdays or Sundays spent at an engine show. He got soft when it came to the grandkids and brought them to White House Farms to run his remote control tugboat and buy them donuts and cider. But enduring the sound of flywheels and backfires and the smell of exhaust stacks was only in the milder months. How many of us can say that we spent many wintry Sundays growing up going skiing right after Mass? Dad did that with us. I think we could negotiate any ski lift by the time we were 5 years old. Dad was fortunate to have shared life with two different and wonderful people, our mom and Cynthia. He wasn't shy about telling us how lucky he was. With a total of 9 kids, 15 grandkids, and countless friends that stretched from coast to coast and oceans away, he was a loved person. It never was a surprise for someone to yell "Norm" from across a parking lot, at a Good Guys event, above the hum of engine shows, at the fair, from a hangar at a tiny airport, or just in the middle of a restaurant. He treated each one like a dear old friend. Dad's love of books, as is Nona's, was evident his whole life. He surrounded himself with them, traveled with them, found ways to connect with people through them, and cherished the ones given to him by his family. On his trips to Columbus or Cleveland, Atlanta or Charlotte, he affectionately called his visits to our homes his 4-star accommodations, no matter where he was. And while he was there, he never missed the opportunity to visit his favorite bookstores. Pop-Pop was a notorious storyteller and often improvised when reading to the grandkids. Not surprising for the person Pop-Pop was, one of his favorite books he read to them was Richard Scarry's Cars and Trucks and Things That Go. Remember the alligator car? I'm sure Dad postulated with his very young grandkids how he could have suggested a few engineering design changes and then sketched them out on his ever-present graphing paper or yellow legal pad he always had handy. Another was Mike Mulligan and his steam shovel. I think Dad liked it so much because Mike Mulligan and the steam shovel liked their foundations to be neat and square. Everything's tidy. It's the way Pop-Pop cared for all of his belongings. In the end of the story, the steam shovel was at long last, repurposed into a boiler in the foundation of the building it had dug. It was like the Industrial Revolution's version of Shel Silverstein's The Giving Tree. The message of Mike Mulligan and a steam shovel, like Pop-Pop, was that they had an interminable work ethic, a great appreciation for machinery, an unconditional and unquestioning love, and was fiercely loyal. Thanks for setting that example for us, Dad. And Pop-Pop, we wouldn't do your memory justice unless we had the last word to let you know how much we all love you and tell you that you're the best.
So I'm Norm's stepson's wife. or as we used to call one another, nothings in law, or knots for short. Not really the basis of a very meaningful relationship, but I honestly love Norm as much or more than any member of my own family. I have a story to share, and I didn't bring notes because it's a story that I tell all the time. And I asked for Cynthia's permission to tell it because it involves Cynthia's ex-husband. But I love it because I think it sums up Norm's character so perfectly. So once when the boys were little, and we were visiting Nona and Pop-Pop in Canfield, John made plans with his dad to go for an outing with the boys, and John's dad was coming to the house to pick them up. And so John told Cynthia, and then Cynthia said to Norm, "Hey Norm, listen, John's dad's coming over in a little bit, and I want you to," and Norm interrupted and said, I know, don't worry, I'll be nice to him." And Cynthia said, "No, that's exactly what I'm worried about. He's just coming by to pick them up. You don't have to invite him in. You don't have to offer him a beer. You don't have to show him around. He's just coming to pick him up, and they're going to go." So a little while later, there's a knock on the door, and Norm answers. And we're not even near the door. We're in some other part of the house. But we hear him yell, "Hey, John, how you doing? Come on in. You want a beer? Let me show you around the shop." So, of course, you know, it went to, you know, Norm was a lovely host, as he always is, and then eventually John and the boys left to go do whatever it is they were going to do together. And so then Norm and I were sitting in the library, where I think a lot of us had our, you know, one-on-one, heart-to-heart talks with Norm, and we were laughing about the incident. And Norm turned to me and said, "You know, as far as I'm concerned, I love that guy. You know, he's one of my favorite people. Because, you know, he made some bad choices in his life, and as a result, I have a beautiful wife and a beautiful family. I owe him everything." So that's what I always think about and always explain to folks when I think of Norm, is just that big heart that finds the best in everyone in every situation. So thank you for letting me be part of your family, and thank you, Norm, for embracing me as your nothing-in-law.
The New Testament readings, I first began a reading with a reading from Romans 12 about the character of a Christian life, a character filled with love and hospitality. I thought so descriptive of the life of Norm. "Let love be genuine. Abhor what is evil, cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Give preference to one another in honor. Not lagging behind in diligence, fervent in the Spirit, serving the Lord. Rejoicing in hope, persevering in tribulation. Devoted to prayer. Contributing to the needs of the saints. Practicing hospitality." The Christian life. Much of Norm's life. As Psalm 130 was a wonderful expression of the gospel message from the Old Testament, so is Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 through 10. But God, being rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our transgressions, he made us alive together with Christ. And for by grace you have been saved. And he raised us up with him and sealed us with him in the seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the surpassing riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand so that we would walk in them. And then from the Gospels, I chose four readings. The first two readings have to do with treasures. And where are our treasures? First, from Matthew chapter 6. I think you know what Norm treasured. Matthew 6, verses, this is from the Sermon on the Mount, verses 19 through 24. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. The eye is the lamp of the body. So then if your eye is clear, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light in you that is in you is darkness, how great is that darkness? No one can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth. And from Luke 12. Jesus said to them, beware and be on your guard against every form of greed. For not even when one has an abundance does his life consist of his possessions. And he told them a parable, saying, the land of a rich man was very productive. And he began reasoning to himself, saying, what shall I do, since I have no place to store all my crops? And then he said, this is what I will do. I will tear down my barns and build bigger ones. And there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have many goods laid up for many years. Come, take your ease, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, you fool, this very night your soul is required of you. And now, who will own what you have prepared? So is the man who stores up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. Just a word before the next reading. You know, where your treasures are. Well, I think Norm had many treasures, but his greatest treasures were you, the family gathered here, the friends who are watching online. The end of 1 Corinthians 13, it says, faith, hope, and love, these three abide, they continue forever. Nothing else does. And the greatest of these is love. He treasured you, and it's a wonderful gift. I'm sure he treasured his work and his engines, but he treasured you more. Then two words about the promise of eternal life. First, from John 11. His close friend Lazarus has just died, and he finally gets to town 4 days later. And Lazarus's sister hears that he's coming and runs out to the edge of town. And Martha then said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Well, of course not. Jesus could have healed him, right? Would have healed him. If you had been here, my brother would not have died. Even now I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise in the resurrection to eternal life on the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even if he dies. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? And she said to him, yes, Lord, I have believed that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, even he who comes into the world. And a final reading, I was requested to read in the King James Version from John 14. This is during the Last Supper, and Jesus is preparing his disciples for his death and departure. Let not your hearts be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And whither I go, ye know, and the way ye know. Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, or how can we know the way? Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but through me. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. Amen. From Luke 12, we talked about treasures. Jesus ended that little parable by saying, so is the man who stores up treasure for himself. He's a fool if he is not rich toward God. Life consists not so much in riches, but in relationships. The riches come and go. The relationships, they're what last forever. Norm understood that. In the passage about treasures from Matthew chapter 6, there was in the middle of the passage a phrase that I thought about this week as I thought about Norm. It says, the eye is the lamp of the body. So then if your eye is clear, your whole body will be full of light. I thought about what caught his eye. We're all drawn to different things. What was catching Norm's attention? Well, what caught his attention were things that needed help. Old engines that needed to be saved. He just somehow couldn't pass them up. He was drawn to them. He saw them in a way, some people would see it, junk. Right? He had a different eye for that junk. He saw potential. He didn't see just what is, he saw what could be. And I think when we can look at each other that way, life becomes full of grace and full of new possibilities. When someone can help me move from today into a new tomorrow, when you can see what is better, his ability to build businesses were the same thing. His attention to saying, I believe something can be better. Something can be possible. What caught his eye was old engines and anything an engine would run. He showed me his dragster, his motorcycles, his cars. And a phrase caught my mind that I heard from Cynthia. That Norm said, I didn't hear him say this, but she said, Norm often said, I don't own them. I'm just the caretaker, the custodian. Well, that's really a biblical way of looking at life. God in the Bible is the maker and owner of everything. So while there is something in my hands that I say, this is mine, my car, my house, my office, whatever, it's not really mine. I'm just sitting in that office. I'm just in that car for a time, and it'll go to somebody else. But what I am is the caretaker. The biblical word is steward. Everything God is the owner of, but he gives to, it's the first command of to Adam and Eve, be fruitful and multiply and care for the earth. Be a caretaker, be a steward. He felt a responsibility for things, and he was gifted. That was seen by one of his shop teachers that asked him to help put things together. And he was, in his own way, perhaps not so trained, but absolutely gifted as a master mechanic and engineer. He could engineer, he could see, he could fix. He had an eye for things that needed saving. Old engines, and people probably too. Another thing that caught his eye was children. His own children, his grandchildren. Foster children. Perhaps they needed a little saving too. But there was something about Norm that he wasn't just doing good for others. There was that genuineness that he saw how good they were to him. It's the story we heard about John and how thankful he was that John had been part of the story. Foster children would see him after they left the home, see him later and just run and give him hugs. So loved they felt by him. Neighborhood children, a neighbor stopped by and told Cynthia that her kids, and she didn't know the story until the neighbor told her, would just wait at the end of the driveway to see Norm's car pass at a typical time because he'd always stop. And he'd always talk to the neighborhood kids. They knew his car. And they looked forward to his coming because Norm had an eye for children. When he was in a restaurant, he'd have an eye for little kids. And little kids would smile at that mustached face, and he'd be waving at them, and they'd be waving at them and at him, and the parents would be worried that they were bothering this other couple. No, he was never bothered. He loved children. His face would light up when he talked to you because he loved people too. He loved most of all his family. He loved that his family was enlarged. I'm thankful for the family sharing, and I know he looked forward to every time you came home for holidays and for the big holiday, Labor Day weekend, the fair holiday. He just loved you being in his life. Norm was so genuine in his affection for you. He had an eye for people. As I heard from the grandchildren, I experienced that he would draw you into conversation. Sometimes the little devil was at work in him, the little pixie. I remember one of my first times sitting with him. He heard that I love to fish and I love to hunt. But he didn't really know what kind of fishing I did. It's trout fishing and fly fishing. So he asked me, well, do you like ice fishing? And he sounded genuinely interested. He was not interested at all. I found out later, he just wanted to know, and I'd never been ice fishing, and I told him that. And the thought of sitting out in, you know, sub-zero weather trying to catch a fish wasn't the most attractive idea. But he was so happy to hear that, and he was smiling, and because he was wanted to see if I was one of those evil people that dug holes in the ice and causes the hump in the ice for when the ice boat would go through. That's what he wanted to know. He loved gathering people. I think the first time I met him was at a groundhog meal, just an occasion for him on Groundhog Day to throw a party and have friends get together for dancing, for food, for music. He drew people into him. He was generous and fun. He would put people to ease. It's possible at a time like this to feel that perhaps the light has gone out. But it hasn't. He's just passed it on to you. And you continue to bear that light. As we began the service today, I said that we would gather, we are gathering to honor the Lord of life and remember his servant Norm. We've been doing that, but we also want to remember the Lord of life, the one who is the good shepherd who journeys with us in the green pastures and in the dark valleys. He's with us here today. Who every day of our life will track us down with his goodness and mercy, and then he will take us to be with him. Jesus is actually looking forward to the day when he can go home, leave the disciples to prepare a place for them so that he can welcome them to their true home, their better home. And he's looking forward to that day, and he says, I will come back for you. Don't be afraid. I'm going to take you to myself. This message of the gospel is proclaimed by Paul so clearly. We were dead in our transgressions. We have no hope. Dead people don't have any hope, except with God. We were dead in our trespasses, our transgressions, but he made us alive. And he raised us up with Jesus and seated us with him in the heavenly places. For by grace you've been saved, through faith only, as a gift from God. Not of works, lest anybody should boast. Good thing it's not by works, because as the writer of Psalm 130 said, O Lord, if you mark iniquities, who could stand? He was a great guy, but he wasn't a perfect guy. Norm wouldn't stand. If God's counting chicken scratches for me, my chalkboard would be white. If, Lord, you count iniquities, O Lord, who could stand? But there's forgiveness with you. The eraser comes out. There's forgiveness with you that you mayest be feared. And he will redeem Israel from all his iniquities through the blood of Jesus Christ. The simple gospel message that whoever believes will have eternal life. Regarding eternal life, Martha thought about it as an event, someone somewhere coming long away. Your brother will rise again. Well, I know he's going to rise again on the last day, but she wanted him now. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. And we believe this first thing. He who believes in me will live even if he dies. We know that Norm is gone. But we believe he will live in heaven forever, and that one day we will join him there. But then Jesus goes on to say another astounding thing. First, he who believes in me will live, even if he dies. But then he says, everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? He asked Martha. But isn't he gone? Yes, he is. But he is fully alive in heaven because Jesus said so. Jesus said he will never die. And so although he has died, which he acknowledged in the verse, the words just preceding, we live even if he dies, he acknowledges death, but he wants to be sure that we acknowledge life, the power of his resurrection, that as he died and was raised, so we are connected to him. And right now, Norm, if it's possible, is more fully alive in heaven than he ever was on earth. That's his promise to you. He's gone from us, but he is not gone. Jesus has prepared a room for him, and he's prepared a room for you. And he came for Norm and took him home. And one day he will come to you, for you, and for all who believe the message of the gospel, that we are saved by his grace as a gift, received by faith. Amen. At this time, we're going to sing the second song, again, printed on the insert in the bulletin, On Eagle's Wings, based on Psalm 91. As it's printed in the bulletin, we confess together our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. At the end of each petition, I will say, God of mercy, and your response is, hear our prayer. Almighty God, in holy baptism, you have knit your chosen people together into one communion, into the body of Christ. Give to your whole church, in heaven and on earth, your light and your peace. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to share the new life in Christ. God of mercy, hear our prayer. We thank you, Lord, for the eternal life Norm has entered, that he is reunited with those who have gone before him, whom he loved, his parents, Gustav and Julia, Sheila and Karen. We pray that you give courage and faith to Cynthia, Colleen, Norman, Michael, Kevin, Rachel, Kathleen, John, Lisa, Elena, to all the grandchildren, the foster children, and to all who mourn. Give to them a sure and certain hope in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may have strength for the days ahead. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, that where this world groans in grief and pain, your Holy Spirit may lead us to bear witness to your light and life. God of mercy, hear our prayer. Help us in the midst of things we cannot understand to believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to life everlasting. God of mercy, hear our prayer. And God of all grace, we give you thanks because by his death our Savior Jesus Christ destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection he opened the kingdom of heaven to Norm and to all believers. Make us certain that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, will be able to separate us from your love in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And we pray together the prayer our Lord Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Come to the commendation prayer. Let us commend Norm to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Norman Erling Anderson. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Thank you for fulfilling your promise and for receiving him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. At this time, we sing our closing song printed on the back of our bulletin, O God, Our Help in Ages Past, sung to the tune of, based on Psalm 90. Amen.